many elements, but one that I would single out would be the willingness to experiment, which is the same as willingness to fail, right? And people, they're afraid to try things sometimes, but that's how we learn. If you want to learn how to ski, if you want to learn how to speak a new language, you have to be willing to do it badly for a little while. And so all innovators are willing to experiment. They're willing to fail, but fail on their way to success. Well, we think that the human element drives most innovations. You know, in the history of innovation, you know, if you go in the back room and come up with a cool technology and bring it out into the world, sometimes the world doesn't want your technology. But if you start from humans and say, what do humans really need? And then if you start from there and think about, okay, what technologies do I have that can help with that human need? We think your innovation has a much, much greater chance of success. Because the anthropologist helps you figure out what problem to solve. You know, people talk so much about problem solving, but really for innovators, there's something that comes before problem solving, and we would call it need finding, right? Customers, humans, have latent needs. They don't raise their hand and say, I'd like an iPhone when one doesn't exist, or a Walkman, or a, you know, Facebook. I didn't know I needed Facebook until Facebook existed, right? And so the anthropologist's job is not to ask people, what do you need? The anthropologist's job is to observe human behavior and figure out what their latent needs are, the underlying needs that the person themselves can't even articulate. So lots of companies want to use a focus group to try to figure out what product or service to come up with next. And we think focus groups have value, but later in the process, when you've already decided what to make and you're trying to decide, should I make the small one or the big one? Should I make the blue one or the red one? Focus group, very good for that. And so at the front end of innovation, we use the unfocus group. We use very unusual people, and we get inspiration from them. Maybe when your product comes out, you want to be right in the center of the distribution curve, the normal distribution curve of people. But that's not where you see discovery. You look at the tails. You look at the early adopters. You look at the people who are slow to adopt, and you get clues from them. And so in an unfocused group, we'll bring in very, very unusual people, sometimes almost scary people. But when we interact with them, then we get ideas that we can apply to regular people in the middle of the curve. Well, the main role of the leader is to make sure that everyone feels empowered to express their ideas, right? That leader may ultimately have the power to decide, right? They might choose among the ideas. They might decide what we're going to invest in and not invest in. And that's fine. They need to maintain control of their power, maybe. But what they don't want is they don't want to be in charge of all the ideas, because then you only have the ideas inside one person's head. If you have 100 employees, you want all 100 of those people to be thinking of new ideas every day. And so that's the leader's job, is to bring out that creative ability in the team. Where do new ideas come from? There's a whole book by Stephen Johnson on that subject, and I know Stephen pretty well. But where do ideas come from for us? We get inspiration on the streets, right? When we're with people, we never bring people into our office and have them, you know, try to use a product or a service. We go out and we observe how people use, and we always find quirky behaviors. We always find surprises. Now, sometimes we can't turn that new insight into a profitable innovation, but usually there's an opportunity there when we go and observe human behavior and we get a new discovery. Yes, well, we call it design thinking, and we've used it in countries all over the world. In fact, we have a toolkit we call this Human-Centered Design Toolkit that we make available for free to nonprofits who want to use it in their work. And people in 140 countries have used it, and they tell us about how they use it. And with my book, Creative Confidence, I've had emails from dozens of countries where people use these exact same ideas and apply them, you know, within their cultures. I'm sure that they are adapting or shaping for their unique circumstances, but the core ideas are all applicable.